We'll move on to the next talk. The next talk by is none other than Dr. Shirisha Senthil. She heads the glaucoma service of the L.V. Prasad Eye Institute, Hyderabad. Dr. Shirisha is a versatile surgeon and a very prolific speaker. Welcome, Dr. Shirisha, and thank you for being a part of our course. Over to you.
Yeah, thanks, Chandrima. So we will start off with OCT in early diagnosis and progression. Glaucoma, as we know, is a progressive disease with loss of retinal ganglion cells and their axons with resultant optic nerve head damage. And what we see in these patients is a progressive loss of visual field as we go by if they are untreated. So our aim is to pick the disease up early, make sure that we don't have so much of a damage by the time it is diagnosed. And once diagnosed, make sure that it is stable. So these are the two aims of the diagnosis of glaucoma and treatment. So how do we pick up change or damage or progression? We can do that by two types of evaluation. One is the structural assessment of the optic nerve head and the retinal nerve fiber layer, and the functional assessment by the threshold perimetry, as well as the other newer perimeters that we are talking about. So structural assessment can be done by clinical evaluation of the optic disc stereophotographs. But we know that it is subjective, and majority of the time, if people are trained well, they would be able to pick it up, but sometimes it's not possible, or untrained people may not be able to pick it up. So, and it is not quantitative. So structural assessment with OCT is very, very important. So if we look at the relationship between the structure and function in glaucoma, we know that they don't go hand in hand all the time. Structural changes precede functional changes the early disease and vice versa later during the disease. And there are multiple reasons for this. Once we detect the disease, what is important is the disease progressing? If we find a change in whatever way we are testing it, whether it is OCT or by visual fields, is it because of the disease progression, or is it because of the measurement variability, or is it because of a natural age-related change? I think this is very, very important for us to know before we call somebody as having a progression, because our diagnosis of progression is going to affect them by either changing the way we treat them, or sometimes even additional surgery may be required. So one needs to be very, very clear about it. OCT is important, like I said. This is a patient with preperimetric glaucoma. You can see an obvious inferior NFL defect. Visual fields are normal. OCT is able to pick it up both in the thickness map as well as deviation map and inferior NFL defect. So which structures are measured? We can measure the retinal nerve fiber layer thickness as well as the optic nerve head changes. And that is shown here as the neuroretinal rim thickness in the graph, as well as the RNFL thickness map, which is measured around the measurement circle. And it also gives the averages of the superior nasal, inferior, and temporal, as well as the clock cover maps. Macular GCC is also used to measure the macular ganglion cell complex, because we know that macular area houses more than 50% of the ganglion cells. So any change, even in early glaucoma, one would be able to pick that up. And the new change that we are able to pick up these days with the help of an OCTA is the blood supply and the blood flow that happens around the optic disc. And this is also shown to be affected, and this can be picked up, but currently we are not using this for detecting progression. You can ask me which one of these is better. Is the RNFL measurement better, optic disc evaluation better, or the GCC better? It is difficult to say, but I'll just share a few examples. This is a patient with an glaucoma, inferior NFL defect, and near notching. Visual fields are essentially normal. OCT is able to pick it up both by RNFL as well as macular ganglion cell complex layer. But what we need to remember is even by HVF, when we do a 10-2 for these patients, I think this will complement to what Rajul just said. 24-2-C is an advantage we have today, that instead of doing two tests, we should be able to do that to pick it up. But by doing a 10-2, a huge defect was there. So it's no more a preperimetric disease, it is a perimetric disease. RNFL and GCC do not correlate always. So this is a question again that is asked. So which sometimes, this is an example where a GCC was able to pick up the inferior RNFL loss, inferior defect or damage, whereas the RNFL was not able to pick up the change. Whereas in the left eye of the same patient, the defect was picked up, or the disease was picked up both by RNFL as well as the GCC apps. So sometimes they do not match. This is what we need to remember. And which one of them is better? In early disease, RNFL thickness performed much better than the GCC. That is very important. In an advanced disease, RNFL is very, very difficult to pick up change because we know what is called a floor effect. I will come to that in a little while. But like in a 10-2, how we use 10-2 for an advanced disease is very important to use a GCC analysis for an advanced disease. So that's important. And especially when you have a disease with HemD more than minus 17, which is a very severe disease, one will be able to pick up nothing on the RNFL analysis. In fact, it's as much as even 10 decibel loss, you will not be able to pick up changes. So RNFL helps, change helps to detect early disease. GCC helps in detecting advanced disease. These are the progression algorithms that we use. And it what it does is it picks up the change that was not present at the baseline by serially focusing on changes that happen as we go by. So that's important. And they are highlighted in different colors, the way we know how these color codings work. But it's important to pick up a change. We also have a trend analysis that tells you what happens over a period of time. And a negative slope is a change, but all negative slope need not be progression. What level of change is very significant? Is significant. A decrease of more than 5 microns in average RNFL thickness is suspicious of a progression for glaucoma. A decrease of more than 7 to 8 microns in a sectoral RNFL thickness suggests progression, and a decrease of more than 4 microns in GCIPL thickness suggests likely progression. These are just guidelines, but they are not hard and fast, but that is something that can help us. Sometimes we may be able to pick up missed changes, so that's also important. This is an example for the same. So also look at the thickness maps before one says that there is no glaucoma or there is no progression. Macular thickness, again, you can go by the macular GCC with a progression analysis as well. Always apply the results in the context of the patient. That's very, very important. Like I said, any negative slope is considered significant, but we need to remember that that may not be clinically significant. So we also have to understand the limitations of any kind of testing device that we use or any kind of technology that we use. Errors due to registration, errors due to coexisting retinal pathologies, errors due related to the operator, segmentation errors, and age-related changes. This is one thing that is very important, age-related decline. We know that normal decline also there is a change, and an age-related decline is very important, and the OCT currently does not take that into consideration before calling somebody is progressing or not. So we may be overestimating a disease if we are not careful. Floor effect is something where if the thickness of RNFL falls below 550 microns, even if the disease is like, let's say, no PLI, we will still be not seeing any decrease in the RNFL thickness. So that is called as floor effect. That is because of the non-neural tissue that it measures. So in an advanced glaucoma, it is not useful to measure RNFL thickness and go by the GCC. Any decentration of the circle, again, can cause changes. Retinal pathologies can cause problems. So these are things that one needs to be cognizant about. And to summarize, glaucoma progression by OCT or picking up the disease early by OCT is very, very important. But one needs to take this in context with the patient, looking at the how the disease
so possibly
IOP as well as the visual fields before one takes a decision and not just go by what is shown by OCT. Thank you.
Dr. Shirisha, for that great talk, informative and relevant, and absolutely the salient features, so to say, broadcasted. Thank you.